It's a wonderful way to think about possibilities. It's a wonderful way to explore exotic politics. It's a wonderful way, it's a freedom. It's a way of doing anything you want. There are all sorts of walls around other genres. Romances, mysteries, westerns. There are no real walls around science fiction. We can build them, but they're not there naturally.
Hustle on over here.
When I was 12, I saw a terrible movie called Devil Girl from Mars, one of those sad 1950s movies. The Martians had, for some reason, lost all their men, so they'd come to Earth to get some more. And for some reason, in spite of the fact that the Martian women were beautiful, the Earthmen didn't want to go. And I turned off the television and said to myself, I can write a better story than that. And from what I've heard, that's the way a great many people start writing, just the idea that what they're seeing is so awful, they can do better. I sat down and began writing my first science fiction story, which also turned out to be my first patternist story. My patternists are people, a gathering of mutants, really. They're not extraterrestrial or anything, and they're not gathered for any particularly good purpose. They're gathered because a rather odious character is lonely and very long-lived, so he breeds them. He also eats them, in a sense. I think, really, a lot of my early writing had to do with my own feelings of powerlessness. So I dealt often with power, with what it did to people, what they did with it when they got it. And what I do in the Xenogenesis books is explain what that is. I have aliens who arrive and who are interested in us because they are natural genetic engineers. They are gene traders, as a matter of fact, but who tell us that we have this conflict within ourselves. All too often, our intelligence serves our hierarchical tendencies so that we tend to one-up ourselves to death. And I have all this going on after a nuclear war when we really have one-upped ourselves to death.
Most of the world, from what little we know of it today, is scarred with strips of impassable land. The sea is run through with deadly currents. Toramon may be the only fragment that can hold life, for all we are sure of. Once man flew to the moon, even to the moving lights in the sky. There were many empires. Often they fought with one another, and that was called a war.
This notion that war is something that makes the whole society pull together. War is something that turns boys into men. That was a view of war that science fiction writers such as Heinlein and Poole Anderson were very much enamored of. And when I looked around at what was happening to the people that you saw coming back from Vietnam or going off to fight in Vietnam, this isn't what I saw.
A small bead of light dropped from one of the airships. For 5 seconds, the sound came on, a concussive rumbling. A broken stud of burning masonry, the remains of the tower, flickered above the hem of buildings. Chaos broiled on the concourse. The newspeaker grill began humming.
Remain calm, citizens, remain
calm. It behooves the writer to realize that certain kinds of questions are going to be asked, like who wins?
And I see the bell down right there. Set me on a eagle's back.
They were taken to the island of Terrabuena for the entire Ortega family to judge them. At the trial, it was revealed that Tomaso Ortega, brother of Luis, actually engineered his brother's assassination using Aubrey as a guided missile. Civil war broke out among the Ortegas. Aubrey and Promise made their escape.
Fly on through the town.
I just created a character who was black. It was no real significance. It certainly never really entered in any of the plots. Characters have made comments on the fact that Aubrey Knight was black, you know, that nigger, this or that. But it doesn't really matter that much. His color is certainly far less important than just his humanity. When I did the book Street Lethal, the sales department at Ace Books felt that if they put a black man on the cover, people wouldn't pick the book up. Now, they were probably correct. You know, this was probably not an hallucination on their part.
It's very hard to say who your audience actually is. You get letters, and the people who wrote the many, many fan letters to Dahlgren, they said, you're writing about me, you're writing about my friend, you're writing about people that I know about, which was a very warming thing to hear. And at the same time, the much rarer letter from the people who didn't like it said, well, these are the people that you're writing about are not people I'm interested in. I don't want to know about these people.
Most black science fiction novels did not, for a long time, until very recently, have blacks represented on the cover. And I guess the only weakness I could say in terms of the artists individually is that they have not done a lot to represent themselves to the black community as being black, because I feel that there's a large untapped market of black people that would be into science fiction and write science fiction and realize that they could if they knew that there were others who already were. It's 3:30 a.m. and you're tuned to listener-sponsored radio WBAI, and this is Night Shift. Who is James Scott? And those are the posters you've been seeing up around the city.
What posters?
The posters that say, who is James Scott?
I haven't seen any posters.
With the hotline.
What hotline?
Who is James Scott, and we're the only people in New York right now who know.
Well, obviously James Scott is me, but in the story, this story takes place in the year 2089, and James works for an organization called the Planetary Law Enforcement Agency. Now, in this somewhat optimistic view of the future, there are no more wars, so technology has become sort of the state of art, and this is a company called Wedgecraft that actually is connected to the PLEA in that they design all the spacecraft and hardware that the PLEA uses.
The year 2089. A shuttle leaves Earth en route to Wedgecraft. Wedgecraft, a vast space station in orbit around Earth. Wedgecraft, an industrial nation to itself.
Science fiction is a great forum for black people to make statements about their existence and the history of their existence on the planet. And that it's the storylines and what happens in them that are more, let's say, political than actually James's character himself. He's a product of his world. And the stories really make more of the statements that have to do with how I feel about being black.
There aren't any black secret agents. Never were. I can't think of one. Except maybe that man Bolton with Fred Williamson, but like, I don't even want to admit to knowing that
blacks
exists.
Always get killed in science fiction.
Yeah, they do. Big time. Paul Winfield. Three times. Three films. All of them bad.
Well, the interesting thing about Paul Winfield seems to have made a career dying to protect white people in movies. I mean, we talk about The Serpent and the Rainbow or Terminator or Star Trek to The Wrath of Khan or Damnation Alley. You know, he's just over and over again, Paul Winfield has died. In the movie Damnation Alley, that was one of the worst cases of it. You have this movie and it stars Jan Michael Vincent and George Peppard and Paul Winfield, and they're traveling across the desert, this atomic wasteland, and this big, motorized, fallout shelter, right? And they go into, I think, Salt Lake City or Las Vegas, something like this, and in the ruins of the city, they find, like, the last living human female, right? It's a white woman. So I was sitting there in the audience. I said, oh, my God, they've got to kill Paul Winfield. because they're not going to act as if he's not interested in her sexually, and they're not going to allow him to compete with her, to compete with Jan McElvincent and George Peppard. So the only conceivable solution was kill him. And 5 minutes later, he gets eaten by giant cockroaches.
It's very important to me now that we have ourselves represented in the future in positive roles, in leadership roles, in roles where we're not the second or underling character or a stereotype, or like Total Recall, where we have gold teeth and drive a cab and turn out to be mutants and traitors, you know. I mean, I've seen that so much, I could name countless films.
The most important change in black involvement in science fiction has actually come in film. I mean, there are a number of directors like John Carpenter and James Cameron who seem to have gone almost out of their way to make sure that blacks are included in their futures. I think that this is a very promising thing and a very positive thing, because film reaches so many people. Television, you know, there's still a lot of problem. Blacks are simply not allowed to act and to be heroic leading figures in television. The audience just doesn't accept it. Television, you know, there's still a lot of problem. Blacks are simply not allowed to act and to be heroic leading figures in television. The audience just doesn't accept it.
Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the starship Enterprise. Its 5-year mission, to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, to boldly go where no man has gone before.
When the show began, and I was cast to develop this character, I was cast as one of the stars of the show. The reality of the matter was that the industry was not ready for a woman or a black, and certainly not the combination of the two. And we have to remember this is 1966, in that kind of role, on that equal basis, and certainly not in that kind of power role. Her evolved because I was reading this wonderful bestseller treatise on Africa called Uhuru, which is the Swahili meaning freedom. And I walked in with that, and for the first 20 minutes of my interview, we talked about this bestseller, Uhuru. And then we finally got around to why I was there. And later, Gene Roddenberry said, I now know, I knew I wanted a black woman in this role. I now know that she should come from the United States of Africa.
Walk and never tire.
Dr. King said to me, don't you understand that you have the first non-stereotypical role in television in a major TV series of importance? And you establish us as we are supposed to be, as equals, whether it's ethnic, racial, or gender.
The Hebrew children.
So often America has scarred this noble dream. People who merely want to be free, being brutalized.
He says, when you are on the screen, you're 10 feet tall. Don't worry about what they do or don't give you. You'll go down in history. I was breathless. And I said, thank you. And yes, I will stay. And I've never regretted it.
The question of what is it that keeps people separate? What is it that keeps nations separate? It's a lack of communication. Culture is defined as the edge over which information flows discontinuously. So telephones and telegraphs and television and computers and things like that make it automatic that human beings are going to want to form groups based upon natural interests rather than upon geographical boundaries. We're in actually the death throes of the concept of nations as entities. So the concept of race will remain, but it's not, I don't think it's going to affect decisions in any profound sense for more than another 30, 40 years.
Well, it's the kind of situation, if you were on a planet and everybody on the planet had three heads, eight arms, and big bulging red eyes, if you saw a human, any race, doesn't matter, you'd be glad to see them. So once that begins to set in, people don't spend so much time quibbling about skin tone and color of hair and all those type of things. Class is still an issue, but not race.
Next week, Birthrights explores the impact of the Gulf War on British Arab identity.